All right, here's the second part of 5.6. It was so vast, I had to break it up into two parts. So in the previous part, what we were doing is learning how to find zeros of polynomial equations, and we use this thing called the rational zero test, rational zero theorem, come up with a list of possibilities, and then we checked them with synthetic division. So here we're learning a couple of ways to cheat, a couple of ways to slim down that list. That list can get pretty long. Where are we supposed to start? That's what we're trying to find out. So the first objective, using a graph to help us find some zeros of polynomial function. It's kind of weird because I want to find zeros so that I can graph the function. But here, we're using the graph to find the zeros. It seems a little backwards. But anyway, that's the way we teach it. The second objective is using what's called the location principle to help us find some of those zeros. And you'll see what that location principle is all about in a bit, in the second objective. Okay, start off with this warm-up activity, this warm-up exercise. It's pretty easy. Wrap your brain around this. So I've got 2 points on my graph. I've got two negative three, this point right down there, and then I got another point at 3, 5. If these are 2 points that are on a polynomial function, then what conclusion can you draw about this graph? It's a polynomial function. Polynomials are continuous, like the graphs. Whenever you draw them, you don't lift up your pencil. What this means is the graph has to connect between those two dots. Something like this. Now, there's tons of ways that these 2 points could have been connected, but here's one of them. And specifically, what it means is, in order to connect those two dots, it has to cross the x-axis. And that's a key point right here. So if I have two values that are on my graph, one above the x-axis, one below, your graph has to cross the x-axis to get from one of them to the other one. Okay, so that's a key thing about today's lesson. So here, just reviewing the rational zero theorem, I know that if I have a polynomial function, what I'm looking for, I'm going to write a fraction, and that fraction is going to come like this. Factors of the constant term, so I take that a sub zero, that constant term, I'll list out all the factors, and I find all the factors of the leading coefficient, the a sub n term, and then I divide those things. Which one goes on top? It's always the constant term up top over the leading coefficient. I'm always dividing by the leading coefficient. Okay. So here's another way to think of the rational zero theorem. So here I've got myself a cubic polynomial. I'm going to go ahead and factor that thing for you like that. Ooh, imagine if you could factor that fast. That'd be pretty sweet. Okay. So there's the factors, and then from each one of those I can pull out the zeros. So the first one is a -5/2. Second one is 3, and then from the last one, I've got -2/3, all right? Okay, so now, working backwards from the factors, let's see what we have. If I were to FOIL out what's right in the middle, FOIL out the factored form, I would get, of course, the expanded form that's right up above it. So I'm not going to FOIL out the whole thing. Just looking at the first terms and the last terms. So if I multiply the 2x times the x times the 3x, multiply all those things together, of course I get the leading coefficient or the leading term of 6x squared. And notice that those numbers, a 2x, a x, and a 3x, they're all factors of 6. In other words, 2 times that 3, this one's times 1, and I get 6 from that. Okay? So if I look at all of the constant terms there, I multiply all those things together, I get a 5 times a -3 times a 2. Multiply those all together, I get that -30. Those are all factors of the -30. And if I look at my answers, that's what I have. I have factors of the 30 on top divided by factors of the 6 on the bottom. That's what the rational zero theorem is helping us do. Now remember, I get a list. Sometimes it's a big list. Not everything in there is going to work. What we're trying to figure out is, how can we slim it down a little bit? Okay, so that's exactly what this is saying. It helps us generate a list of possible factors, and we're going to test each of those things by synthetic division. Verify if they work or if they don't work. So this first exercise, list the possible rational zeros of this equation. I'm not solving it just yet, just listing out all of the possibilities. So I know I need all of the factors of the 24 divided by all the factors of leading coefficient is 1. And we've seen from experience that whenever the leading coefficient is 1, all of our possibilities are just going to come from the constant term. So writing those out in order, x could possibly be equal to plus or minus. 1 goes into it, 2 goes into it, 3, 4, 6 goes into it, 3 times 8 goes into it, 2 times 12, and then finally 24. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times 2, positive and negative, 16 different things that we could possibly have to test. 16 different things. Okay, so now let's find all of the zeros. Well, we had the list on the previous example. Let's just try one of them, divide it out, see what the answer is. So how about we start with 1. Okay, so 1.
Across the top, I got a 1, a negative 12, 35, a negative 24. And now I'm going to do my synthetic division on this. 1, 1, negative 11, multiply negative 11, add these things, 24, good. Okay, and then multiply positive 24, and look at that, it worked. Excellent.
So what I'm left with here is a quadratic, x squared minus 11x plus 24. And then I'd go and I'd factor that thing. So open up my parentheses, about an x and an x. They got to multiply up to 24, and they have to add up to negative 11. So how about it is a negative 3 and a negative 8 and a negative 3, which means x could be equal to 1, 8, or 3. All right, there we go. All right, so that part is not too terrible, and it's always very convenient. It's always very nice if the first one works, if the number positive 1 works. It's not always going to be like that. Let's take a look at this one. So on this next one, I got a leading coefficient of 2. I'd recommend just right beside that 2, just go, oh, my factors are 1 and 2. And my factors of the 14, 1, 2, 7, and 14. Divide them out. Which ones go on top? The factors of 14. So x could be equal to 1, 2, 7, and 14. That's plus or minus out front. If I divide them all by 1, and then, if I divide them all by 2, 1 half, 2 halves, same thing as 1, 7 halves, 14 halves, same thing as 2. So there it is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 12 possibilities. Now, it didn't seem too bad when it was just 14, where I just had those 4 factors. But then, I increase the number whenever I have a leading coefficient that's not a 1. So that's what this is commenting about. Whoops. All right. So when the leading coefficient is not a 1, the number of possible rational zeros really, really gets big. And so we want some shortcuts. We want a way to trim that list down. So a couple more little tiny exercises. Wrap this thing up. According to the rational zero theorem, what's the maximum number of possible rational zeros that you would have to test for this polynomial function? Well, I hope that you have picked up from this so far, from experience, that I can only have 3 possible answers, so 3 zeros. If you haven't, well, there you go. Now, I'm going to have more than 3 possibilities from the rational zero theorem. How many possibilities am I going to have? Well, if this leading coefficient is 1, what I'm looking at is all the possibilities, all the possible factors of D. So all the possible factors of D. Whoa. What is that word? Of D. Almost. I also have all of this times 2. Why? Because I could have all the positive ones, and then I could have all the negative ones. So, there you go. Now, what if instead I have a leading coefficient that's an a? So what I'm saying here is that a has k factors, however many that is. That could be 2, 3, 4 factors, whatever. And d has r factors. Now, if I do the rational zero theorem on this to list out all the possibilities that I'd have to check with synthetic division, how many maximum could there be? Well, I'm taking all of the factors of D, which there are R of them, and I'm taking all of the factors of A, which there are K of them, and I'm dividing those out. How many possibilities are there? That is R times K. That's a lot. And that's what's called a multiplication principle. If I can do something in K ways and I can do something in R ways, then to do them both together, I multiply them. A little bit different here, and that is I have to times that by 2 because I could have the positive and the negative. What this is showing you, if I look back at the other one, it was just 2 times the number of factors of that that constant term. But once I throw in that leading coefficient that's not a 1, I've just multiplied all the numbers that I could possibly have to check. And as I said, what we're trying to do is come up with a way to shorten out that list so it doesn't take a year in order to solve some of these problems, right? All right, so check me out in the next video. That was just the intro video.